Greetings, everyone. Thanks for tuning in. It's Kevin continuing our countdown of the 30 best albums of 2021. Picking up at number 15, my number 15 album of the year is Prince with Welcome to America. And no one is more surprised than me to be including a Prince album this many years after his death. This posthumous record, though, would stand as the best thing that Prince has released in the last 15 or so years. Let's be honest, as much as every one of us love Prince, and he is untouchable and an icon in every regard, but that classic work of the 80s and into the 90s, and even the underappreciated work he did in the latter 90s and maybe the earliest of the 2000s, was not the consistent quality that was demonstrated in the last 10 or 15 so years of his life. That makes it actually even more curious that Welcome to America sat on the shelf, that Prince actually wrote, produced, recorded this, and apparently tracked it as a piece of work, not just a random bunch of songs that has been put together after his death. Apparently this was his vision for this album, and then he chose not to release it at the time that it was recorded. And had he done so, who knows? He may have had the latter part of his career, the part that a lot of people, you know, rightfully show as maybe the erosion of his skills or the need of an editor. Had he actually released this album during his lifetime, it may have provoked a reassessment. I actually was shocked when I heard it. I thought it might be a post-death cash grab from the estate to, you know, as they raid the vaults, putting out whatever they can find. But this is very high quality Prince work, especially, I guess, latter-day Prince work. You're not going to find Purple Rain Part 2 here. This is not that type of album. But it really is something that shows that Prince could still bring the goods when he wanted to. It has everything from the playful sexual innuendo that he sort of went away from after becoming a devout Jehovah Witness. Those hallmarks from his early career, there's a couple of songs that point to that. It's funky, it's topical. It's topical even today, despite the fact that this is a material that was recorded more than 10 years ago. It's very prescient in speaking to today's political and technological environments. It's just a fun record all the way around. Actually, one of my favorite songs on it, I looked it up to see, you know, a little more information about it when I found out it wasn't a Prince original, and he actually does a Soul Asylum cover on here. You might remember Soul Asylum. Runaway Train was their big hit alternative rock band from the 90s, so who knows what caused Prince to decide that he was going to cover them, but he did to great effect. Much must hear if you're a Prince fan that hasn't tuned in a while. You will be pleasantly surprised. Moving on to number 14, we have the latest record from Robert Plant and Alison Krauss. Raise the Roof is the name of the album, and this is the first time these two have recorded together since all the way back in 2007 when the Raising Sand LP won Album of the Year at that year's Grammys. I don't know why it took them this long to do a follow-up, but it's lucky for us that they did. They are very much an odd couple. He the golden god of heavy metal from the 60s into the 70s, and she is a bluegrass queen. You'd think they not have a lot in common, especially when it comes to the fact that a lot of these songs that they're covering are Americana, folksy, country-ish, seems a lot more out of Robert Plant's wheelhouse, but this odd couple make it work. The magic that they showed on Raising Sand is apparent on Raise the Roof, and those voices, though opposite, work extremely well together, and they are very good curators. They have picked very wisely the material and the covers they do. This is probably a less ebullient record than the original album that they did together back in 2007. However, despite some darker corners, it's still a lot of fun and playful. Particularly to me, the Lucinda Williams cover that they do is very, very good. So check out Raise the Roof. If you liked Raising Sand, you're going to love this just as well. It's almost that album's equal in my mind. That's high praise too, considering the quality of that record. Number 13 is Crowded House, Dreamers Are Waiting. If all you know of Crowded House is Don't Dream It's Over, the hit they had in the 80s, then you have certainly missed out. To me, I don't think any conversation about the most overlooked bands in the history of rock and roll would be complete without mentioning Crowded House. I believe that though they were superstars in their native Australia, they are vastly underrated for the work they did in the 80s and then throughout the 90s, that being their first run. After the untimely death of their drummer, they called it quits, but early in the 2000s, Neil Finn, the leader of Crowded House, reconvened the band, and they sort of have had a pretty quiet but successful second life. And those albums that they've done, even though they've been more sparing in this past couple of decades, those that have come out have been of extremely high quality, and Dreamers Are Waiting may be the best of the bunch. It's certainly not the exception as far as the quality that they continue to put out. Neil is a very good songwriter. It still has the pop dreaminess and catchiness with just enough quirkiness that it has the hallmarks of classic Crowded House. Might not be as immediate as their younger selves, and that's okay and to be expected that you start to lean maybe a little more adult contemporary at their ages. However, repeated listenings are rewarded. Each time you hear, you'll notice some sonic difference, some subtleties that maybe you didn't before, and then the melodies really do start to ingrain themselves the more that you listen to the album also. Very strong album and a welcome return from Crowded House. Moving on to number 12, we have the Mountain Goats, Dark in Here. John Darnielle is probably the one of the finest songwriters of his generation. He can be both clever and emotional, and sometimes both at the same time. The title track to this one is evidence of that. The weight of Mountain Goat songs can be pretty vast. They can lure you in with some wit, and then before you know it, you are being emotionally devastated or feel like you're learning something more about yourself, learning something more about life. They're filled with a lot of wonderful lessons, and the Mountain Goats tend to vacillate back and forth between either extremely lo-fi boombox style recordings, which really were the hallmark of their early career when John was pretty much the one-man band doing it all, to now that they are a full touring band is now the studio band as well, and they're all brought in, and they sometimes stretch out into these gorgeous finally produced work, and that's what Dark in Here is. It leans more towards that side of the Mountain Goats personality. And it continues their winning streak of just quality work. This album is well produced, put together. The songs ride along, buoyed by piano and a Wurlitzer organ, and so those sounds themselves evoke a certain feeling within you, and those feelings tend to be complemented by the stories that John are telling. So the Mountain Goats are very prolific, and this is like their third album in the last year and a half. This one, though, is the most fully realized and definitely the one that you should give a listen to. And we end this part of our 2021 Best Of list at number 11. The number 11 album of the year is the eponymously titled My Morning Jacket album. It's their ninth album, and it is their best album, in my opinion, since 2008's underrated Evil Urges. I say that because we all love My Morning Jacket. If you are from Kentucky, you have to love My Morning Jacket, and they have produced a lot of quality work over the last 10, 12 years. However, it has not been as consistent as the work they did prior to their classic album, Z. Everything before Z, and including Z, is really the gold standard of My Morning Jacket's material. They still had some good stuff after, but little did we know how close we were to losing them as a band. In press for this album, they admitted that they weren't sure if they were breaking up or it might have been the end of My Morning Jacket. They got together just to see if there was any magic still there and were pleasantly surprised to find that it was. This is the first time they'd been in a studio together in more than 6 years. We've had a couple of albums that have come out in that time, but those were albums that had been in the can. So this was them testing the waters again to see if they still had what it takes, and fortunately they did. What they produced is something that, because they self-produced it, it sounds a lot like the early Silo days when they would record their indie rock with all that reverb and echo in the barn silo here in Western Kentucky. So I think it was a good decision for them to produce themselves, because it kind of marries that sound of At Dawn and those records with the song structures that is more familiar with the Z, Evil Urges, and later period, where they were more experimental. So you kind of get the best of both worlds. Whatever style of My Morning Jacket you like, it's evident here. Whether it's some of the sensitive, gentle finger-picking acoustic numbers, or the long 8 or so minute long prog rock, indie rock jams that they're also known for. Sometimes you get both in the same song, such as the song In Color, which starts out as the dreamy little ballad and then explodes into an outro part that stretches on many minutes while Jim James shreds on his guitar. So if all of that sounds good to you, then you're going to love the new My Morning Jacket record. If you've been a fan of theirs in the past and thought that maybe they didn't have anything to offer you any longer, or weren't as impressed with the last few albums, you have to give this 9th album, titled My Morning Jacket, a chance. It is my number 11 album of the year. We move into the top 10 when I see you again in our next segment. Thanks for joining.